Well, welcome everybody to Who's Outside Building an Anti-Racist Bookshelf. This is a workshop brought to you in partnership between Tarrant Institute of Innovative Education and Shelburne Farms. We're so happy that you're here today with us. My name is Aimee Arandia Østensen. I am a professional learning facilitator in education for sustainability at Shelburne Farms.
My name is Jeanie Phillips, and I am a professional development coordinator at the Tarrant Institute for Innovative Education at the University of Vermont, and a former school librarian, and always in my heart, a school librarian. And I see many librarians in the house, and I'm so happy that you're here. And I'm also the host of a podcast I wanted to share with you, partly because somebody at work told me I should, and partly because we have conversations about the kind of books we're going to talk about here all the time. And I think it's something you might want to know about as an opportunity to join those conversations, maybe be a guest on the podcast with me to talk about a book. I'm always looking for guests to talk about good books or to discover some books yourself.
So Jeanie, do you want to kick us off with some agreements that we're holding for one another today?
So conversations about race and racism can be really challenging. And so we're going to lean on these norms, these working norms. They are inspired by the Courageous Conversations Agreements, and we're just going to use them to support our learning together. And the first one is expect and accept non-closure. We're not going to solve racism in this 1.5 hours.
And the second one is experience discomfort. Sometimes our most interesting learning happens in those spaces where we're unsettled a little bit, and we push our understanding of what is maybe normal or what we're used to and kind of question that a little bit. So expect to be a little bit discomforted, and we ask that you lean into that and embrace it as the process of learning.
Engage in both and thinking. We're not going to be absolutionist about this. We're really going to be able to hold multiple truths or paradox.
And lastly, we ask that you engage with respect and an open mind. We are 35 people all together here, and we each come with our own perspective. And certainly what we're sharing with you today is not a universal perspective, but really coming out of our shared thinking. And we're so interested in hearing what you all have to contribute to this conversation as well. Our starting point for this is that we're entering into this with a few assumptions about the world that we live in. So first, we communicate our values and beliefs through the books that we share with students.
Second, racism is systemic. It's infused into our cultural, economic, educational, governmental systems, as well as our values and patterns of thinking. It's not about individuals being mean or nice. It's about systems.
Third, living within racist systems influences who has what type of relationship with the natural world. And I would expand that to include all types of settings and who really has access to different aspects of our world.
There is no neutrality. We have to choose. We can perpetuate systemic racism, or we can be anti-racist. There's no middle ground.
And our final assumption to start with is every child has the right to a sense of belonging in our communities, classrooms, and the natural world. I personally set this as a goal or an outcome, a desired outcome of our educational system. For each individual and for our collective society. Okay, Rudine Sims Bishop wrote this, I would say, paper on mirrors, windows, and sliding glass doors. Jeanie, was it back in the 90s?
1990.
So here goes. Books are sometimes windows, offering views of the world, that may be real or imagined, familiar or strange. These windows are also sliding glass doors, and readers have only to walk through in imagination to become part of whatever world has been created and recreated by the author. When lighting conditions are just right, however, a window can also be a mirror. Literature transforms human experience and reflects it back to us. And in that reflection, we can see our own lives and experiences as part of the larger human experience. Reading then becomes a means of self-affirmation, and readers often seek their mirrors in books. So I'm gonna leave this quote up for you, and I'm gonna ask that you select a phrase that is sticking out to you or maybe is causing you to pause and think for a moment. So pick a phrase from this that is lingering with you or maybe has hit you in a different way today and put that in the chat box. We're gonna move into a think, pair, share moment. And we're asking you to reflect on yourself as a reader, maybe in your youth or as an adult. When has a book served as a mirror, window, and sliding glass door, or when has it not? Give yourself a moment to think about that. An example of a book in which you've seen yourself reflected or the possibilities, or you've been transported into another world. And if that has not been your experience, you can give the counter story to that in your experience. And we'll go into pairs for about 6 minutes, 7 minutes, so that each person has about 3 minutes to share about your book and talk about your book with the partner. We do ask that you attend to this with open mind again and enter into a listening mode when listening to your partner speak. We're gonna take that thought and that thinking and just carry it forward and move into exploring an infographic here. And I'm gonna start screen share and turn it over to Jeanie.
Many of you have probably seen this infographic. It's called Diversity in Children's Books. This is the 2018 version they do on every couple of years. And it comes from David Huck and Sarah Park Dallin. They use statistics that are from Wisconsin Cooperative Children's Book Center at the School of Education at the University of Wisconsin in Madison. Sorry, let's see. Somebody's having trouble hearing, and so they're going to step out and step back in. Sorry. This one was published in June 2019 about the 2018 publishing about books published. And so I'm just going to ask us some questions, and I'm going to invite you to unmute yourself and popcorn style jump in or add in the chat. And the first question I have for you is, what do you see?
I have seen several things like this before. It's always upsetting that the bear or the animals have more almost combined as all the minorities.
I'm also looking at like the equity issue, because when you go from left to right, the Native Americans, First Nations, they have very little. And as you go to the white, you just see more and more and more. And like, they have everything. They have everything they could want, where everyone else is left with scraps, it seems.
The mirrors get bigger as you move left to right as well. And there are more mirrors in the white boy has lots of mirrors. And look at all of the images that he sees of himself.
The black child, African-American black child, her mirror's broken.
I don't know if it's intentional or not, but they made the white person a boy versus girl.
I was curious about that too.
I'm going to move us along a little bit from what do you see to what does it imply? What are the implications?
I think it implies that we can look at the white character seeing themselves in all and having that imagination to be whatever they want. And as the representation gets smaller, you don't have as many, your mirror is smaller. So your imagination can maybe constricted a bit.
I think he also is thinking of himself and not of others.
Yeah, I agree with that comment. I also see lots of ego around the white boy. He's not only able to imagine himself, but he seems to be the center of his own world and maybe perhaps that of others' worlds too.
I have looked at this infographic dozens and dozens of times, but I'm just now noticing that he's a king in one, an astronaut in another. He's got a superhero mask in another one of the mirrors, he's a fireman in another one, a baby. I don't know. I don't even know what that other one is.
He's got the possibilities are limitless. Like there's nothing he can't be or choose to be. The world is his oyster. Is that the right word? The world is his oyster.
Some folks in the chat are saying that the purple seems like it's inside and the beyond the bear is on the outside, or that room is plain. And then I see, we still center whiteness. And if it is a mirror, then that sends a message to our POC children in schools. It doesn't match their existences. And their options grow as you move from left to right.
It's also very interesting that, you know, the animal, which is something we normally think of on the outside, is like, as I said, kind of there in the middle or set up as the divide. And then the people, you know, the POC are on the outside and not able to get into inside spaces.
Thanks for sharing. I feel like we could talk about this for a lot longer, but I want to move us along a little bit. Aimee and I have been working really hard in thinking about this. Rudine Sims Bishop works gets quoted a lot without her name, and I believe in citing Black women. And so we're going to give her credit, but this idea of windows, mirrors, and sliding doors gets used a lot without crediting her. And this graphic representation really focuses on mirrors. How are books a mirror? Do they provide representation for our students to see themselves or not through literature? And I want to push us a little bit further. If we change the metaphor, if we were to take it and not focus on books as mirrors, but to focus them on them as windows, what might this graphic organizer look like? What might a visual representation of how books are windows, how might it look differently? And we're gonna ask you to do some work in breakout rooms. We've made these slides so that you can edit them. And we want you to play for a little bit, to have a conversation and use words or images. You might use clip art, drawings, photos, sketches, doodles, whatever, to sort of think about what would it look like if this was not mirrors, but windows instead. Welcome back, welcome back. I know you didn't get enough time. We're gonna ask you, you know, that's part of the discomfort, lean into that discomfort. And the other part of the discomfort is we're gonna ask you, somebody from your group, to step up and just say really like 30 seconds, no more than a minute, of why you chose the images you chose. So could somebody from breakout room 6 give us a little pop in, unmute yourself and tell us a little bit about your images?
I can jump in and I'll give the images credit to my group mates. They did a great job. But we who are thinking about the windows, we were thinking that as it goes, it would become like foggier, where it's harder to kind of see the world from your perspective because it's not quite as clear. So we tried to find different windows of fogginess.
Thank you so much, Kelly.
You're welcome.
How about group 5? Tell us about your images. You're on, Pamela.
Oh, gosh, okay. Well, in the very top left corner, I pulled a peephole because I was thinking of the Native Americans and what they get to see is just that tiny little bit, that little peek. One of the lovely people, we were debating what the rose window here from Notre Dame really represented. And one said, you know, the colorful stories of the Native Americans, which I totally get. but I was thinking, well, I know that's in France. I know that's in Paris. And that's really about like the Western European view and how they're centered and they have all the different windows available to them and all the different colors that they can do anything they want. You know, when you see that, it's just ever expanding feeling. We're thinking of the animals and we have caves and we have animals in zoos. And like, what is that perspective? And then, oh, I cannot remember who it was that mentioned the barred windows. Someone please like chime in here with me. Oh, but the one thing with the porthole, which is another great window. And to me, I think of the African slave ships. And maybe that was what our ancestors were able to see last as they were coming and being shipped from their homeland into slavery. What did that look like for them? I have a very minute little bit of Senegalese in me. And so when I think of that, those ancestors, what was that for them and their perspective? I love the shattered window. And then part of me thinking that as a woman of also breaking that glass ceiling, but there's so many. And then someone did the windows for Microsoft and, you know, technology window. How can we see into the world? There's many. I had a great team, but you guys can speak. I'll be quiet.
Thank you, Pamela, for sharing your team slide. Let's move to breakout room four. Tell us about your images and your words.
So we talked a lot and then kind of settled on these two very contrasting images. One person whose windows that they're looking into are very, or looking out of kind of are very expansive, and another view that's just very, very narrow, and just thinking about what is being published. And when somebody's looking for a window beyond their, like a, you know, white kid sees so much of themselves that their windows are actually pretty small. And so when, you know, the opposite, sorry, my thinking is unclear, but I think you get the idea. The publishing, because there's so few books published about people who are not white, then that's a very narrow window of other people getting to see their, not their own experience when they're reading.
Yeah. Thank you, Lauren. Let's look at slide 14 is group, breakout group three.
We also had a great discussion in starting with just kind of really clarifying the difference between windows and doors and what that means for students. And then we stole your graphic and or the graphic you used, and decided that if those mirrors were windows, that all of those students may be seeing the same vista or having the same experience through a book that they're reading. If it was a book in common, for example, they could be transported into that world. However, because of their differing experiences with what they're reading and seeing through a window, there might be some fogginess. Mm-hmm. So we, I think I've seen it kind of go both ways, where white students have read books that depict African American culture, for example, and see into another world, but have some fogginess because of their differing experiences. We also said, though, that in general, it's easier for white students to kind of access those windows because they have more experiences. Carrie in my group was talking about her, the students she works with, and that being true. Anyone else, group mates?
I'm actually not gonna allow space because our time is so limited and I know what's on the agenda. So let's quickly break out room two. Jules, you said you were part of that group. I hope you don't mind if I just appoint you spokesperson.
That's totally fine. I think that our slide has been evolving. So it's looking a little different here than what I was thinking, but I can tell you our thinking anyway. We were imagining that for a white student, what their window is like standing inside a snow globe, that everything you're looking at is kind of a window into whiteness, but also a mirror at that, like at the same time, that like all you're seeing are experiences of yourself and like your white experience or white male experience, especially. Like, I'm just so shocked by how many like movies and books like need something that I've just been noticing a lot. But and then outside of the snow globe, we have anyone who doesn't fit that like majority identity. And so they're both seeing a lot of this like encompassing large mirror/window into whiteness of the snow globe, but then also that there are these other windows too where they might be seeing a little bit of themselves. And also the white child in the snow globe might see a little bit of themselves. Sorry, this is feeling very abstract based on what you're seeing on the picture, but just bear with me. And that for the white child, it's really hard to almost see out that window and into the other one because the whiteness is so encompassing, but it's there very much for the other like non-male, non-white, like other minority for different reasons, children, very much there for them to see. And also these other windows are a little bit there for them to see too. But hard for the white child, the white male child, to necessarily see out. Anyway, that felt like very like interpretive, but that was some of the thinking that we had anyway.
Very quickly, breakout group one, could you just give us a quick...
Okay, so we were struggling with deciding if we're supposed to find images or if we're supposed to draw them. So forgive the blankness, but we do have like ideas. So our first thought, we were thinking of like the left hand of the infographic, like the less represented people of color and minorities, was like when they look out their window, they see like, you know, in the city when you see a brick wall. There's just like, you look out the window and there's a brick wall. It's like nothing really to look out onto. And then we also talked about like, you know,
moving. Did my dog hat come up?
What?
There it is.
Oh, I forgot Marissa did a drawing. I apologize, Marissa. So, and then we were also talking about when you live in like a basement apartment and you look out the window and all you see is people's feet. So like kind of like moving from like that end of the spectrum to the other, towards the other end or the whiter end of the spectrum. And like the white kid would have like numerous windows or different types of windows, or it would look out into different places. Like, cause we kind of interpret it as like your availability of seeing outside of what you like know exists within your small perspective. So there's like lots more opportunity and availability to like imagine or see yourself in different like situations or places if you are white, versus you have very limited representation and very limited views if you are a person of color, or pretty much anybody below an animal apparently. So
I'm sorry that we cut you off and made it so brief. I feel like I could listen to you talk about this for ages. I'm so excited, but we also know we have other things to get through. And so Aimee's gonna talk to us a little bit about our collective imagination.
Thanks. So I'm gonna think a little bit about windows. And if we're not thinking critically about the windows that we're opening through stories, what we might be perpetuating by not thinking about it. So I have two quotes. I'll read them for you here. The problem of representation has created cord in the collective imagination. So that idea of books as windows to what's possible. And then specifically thinking about the outdoor world. This is from Ashley Fetters. Sure, Black kids in picture books sometimes explore urban landscapes, encounter animals, garden, farm, or travel to new environments in their imagination. She was referring to another writer. Sometimes they learn to navigate the untamed outdoors as they escape from slavery. But by and large, according to children's literature, Black children don't hike or camp or birdwatch for fun. So that I feel like these quotes are kind of responding to a lot of what you were all saying in terms of interpreting that infographic as a window, and what we all might be seeing of the world through our books. So here are two stereotypes that appear often in our media world when we're not intentionally seeking out diverse stories about real people. So in relation to the outside world, we often have this idea of the ecological Indian, the Indian who's just naturally born to be in touch with the wisdom of the land. And I often think of that PSA from when I was young of the crying Indian because the environment was getting polluted. And then we have that idea that Black people don't camp, Black people are only urban. And that's really contextualizing people, certain kinds of people in certain spaces. And Ashley Fetters is pointing out that right now, the environmental crisis that we find ourselves in right now, it's particularly bad that we're not intentionally creating space for a sense of everyone to belong in our natural spaces. So we're gonna take these stereotypes and then send you off into paired listening rounds. I'm gonna give you a moment to think about questions before you go into the break rooms. And then we'll go in listening rounds, which means if Jeanie and I were partners, we would give space, for example, for Jeanie to respond to the first question. And then we would switch. She'd give space to listen to me so I could speak about question one. And then we'd go into the second question. I'd hold space for her. She would hold space for me. And then the third question. It's not really engaging in a dialogue. It's really about listening to one another's perspective. So the questions. What media have we been exposed to that perpetuate these stereotypes? And you can think back through your bookshelf, perhaps, or specific other sources of media. What myths or stereotypes might your students come away with from the books that they've been exposed to at school? And this is like, again, it's about the collection. It's not individual books necessarily. And three, how are people of color showing up in the literature your students see? And more specifically, in what contexts? So I'll give you 1 minute to think silently on these questions as Jeanie sets up rooms, and then she'll magically send you off for, let's see, for 5 minutes. Okay, I'm gonna go into the next slide and we can talk through these paths forward. We don't wanna leave you with all of this discomfort and unsettlement. We wanna leave you feeling empowered with a few choices.
You can tell because we keep using her quotes that we're big fans of Ebony Elizabeth Thomas and her book, The Dark Fantastic. And she talks a lot about, this isn't just a matter of like parody on the shelves, it's also about our collective imagination. And the development of our imaginations is impacted by what we're seeing in media and especially in books. And so we wanted to give you these paths forward. And it's really a path with many entry points. And that first entry point is to start with your books. Look at your bookshelf or your curriculum or the stacks of books you teach. Literally, I want, and if you do this, take a picture and send it to me. I want somebody to go into their classroom and stack up the books that they're gonna expose children to for the year, and one stack be written by white folks and the other stack be written by people of color, and see literally how that stacks up. I think it's an important first step. And so we've provided—
Where are the characters? Because I think some of our books that we teach are written by white people, but they have minority characters.
We're gonna talk about that, Marissa, and we're gonna talk a little bit about own voices and who has the right to tell whose stories. But what I think I usually do it by authors. I think about which authors' books are we buying, which authors' words are we promoting. I just find that a cleaner way to do it. And then we have some links to how to do a library audit that we did with some middle school partners. We have another story about how students, you can engage students in this work. And then a classroom library questionnaire. We encourage you to follow through on these.
And we're also suggesting that you commit to filling in the gaps and expanding the perspectives represented so that those windows aren't just a snow globe, but have many more shades and stories and voices in there. So we've got a number of fantastic links for you here to do that, to fill in the gaps, add different perspectives, consider who's telling the story and whose voices are missing, and diversify. I'm gonna talk about this. So after you do your audit, as Jeanie was suggesting with the book stacks, go back, audit again. Challenge single stories, myths, and stereotypes. Consider these questions as you're looking at the bookshelf. Does it only include characters of color who are showing up to tell the story of history and struggle and trauma? Or does it also include stories about ordinary people with families and love and joy, and counter storytelling? So the more characters and people we get to know, the more we suck the power out of those stereotypes. And I also want to put a little bit of a kind of a flag. Sometimes what we do when we diversify our bookshelf is we add books of Black heroes. And so especially this time of year, you'll have lots of books that are on the shelves about Martin Luther King and Rosa Parks and some amazing people from American history that are people of color. If we only limit our books of that feature people of color to those heroes, then it sets a different kind of limitation for who we can envision doing what kind of things in our world. And I'm just gonna mention this next resource that popped up in my world today that I was so excited about. I wanted to share it with you. This Joy Trip Reading Project, Storytelling for a Sustainable World. And it's a reading group, it's a book list, it's a project about getting these stories about people in the enjoying outdoor recreation, enjoying a relationship with nature that are voices of Black writers of their own experiences.
I'll just add that link at the top that says counter storytelling, Ebony Elizabeth Thomas talks a lot about counter storytelling and retelling stories from the perspective of Black characters. And there's a great syllabus linked there. We have many great resources, but I just want to highlight that one. Finally, our last entry point is particularly for folks who are white. So if you're not white, you get to take a break right now. But if you're white, there's work you need to do aside from just looking at your bookshelves. If you're not, and I love this quote, so I'm just gonna share it. If you're not listening, not exposing yourself to unfamiliar perspectives, not watching videos, not engaging in conversation, then you are perpetuating white privilege and white supremacy. You're opting out because you can. It is exactly your ability to not hear, to ignore the situation that is a mark of your privilege. People of color cannot turn away. Race affects our lives every day. We must consider it all the time, not just when it is convenient. And that's Julia Blount. And so we're gonna ask you to really think about what voices are you, what do you read for pleasure? Are you reading voices of color for pleasure? Are you watching media that features non-white characters, non-white perspectives that's produced and written by non-white creatives? And are you willing to step into that uncomfortable place and learn what you need to learn in order to teach a book well? And so the links on this, Should I Teach This Book, is an invaluable resource to say, if you're going to teach a book that has racism in it, then you need to be prepared to do that work. And you need to learn about racism and anti-racism. So I put a link to BARWE, Becoming Anti-Racist White Educators, to consider starting a group of colleagues or friends who want to do the work that belongs to white people. White supremacy is a white problem and needs white people to dismantle it. And so we invite you, we have an invitation to accountability for you. And so given these paths forward, did you notice an entry point for yourself? What is one small thing you can commit to? Might you take a moment and share that commitment in the chat so that you have accountability partners? Might you just say, I commit to doing this, or this is my entry point? We invite you to do that in the chat as a way of publicly acknowledging the work you're agreeing to do moving forward.
There are so many possibilities. The only thing I want to remind folks of is that within this slideshow, there are so many rich links and that you should definitely take the time to open them one at a time because it can be overwhelming, but there's something in there for each of you.
You know, the windows, that peephole or that broken foggy window, that snow globe, we start with ourselves, right? We start by expanding our own windows if we want to expand the windows for our students, especially the windows, especially for our white students, and the mirrors for our students of color.
So in order to create this change, it requires emancipating the imagination itself. I found this quote to be so captivating because I don't even realize how limited my imagination has been through all of the media I've consumed in my life. But when I look at this, I don't know if you all are Bridgerton fans. I'm not making this recommendation for your students, but for
me. No, this is great. Thank you. I was going to write it in the chat. Thank you, Aimee. This is so good. And I love Shonda Land. She's amazing. Sorry.
No, thank you. I just recently started watching Bridgerton, and when I first saw it, it just exploded so many limits in my brain and that I didn't even know I was holding. So you might be thinking, what are these women of color doing in these royal British Jane Eyre era costumes? And then it just struck me so strongly that like, I have a limit on what's possible in my brain. My imagination has been limited about who can do what and fulfill what roles. And that even the idea that all these women should be white because that's what I've been presented my whole life. And so I am still thinking about this, but I wanted to surface this as an idea and a little bit of a prompt. So what if we reframed our windows that we've been playing with now about what our bookshelf is. And we think about it as an opportunity for future visioning and fantasy and possibility. The prompt here is, what possibilities do you want to imagine into being? And we're gonna leave it really wide open and loose. I wanna say thank you so much for diving into this. I know it was fast and furious. And hopefully this is just the beginning of your thinking about what's possible and what that window of possibility is. So because of time, we're just gonna do this silently and appreciate the thinking that you all got started here. So I'll just move us through these slides. And Jeanie and I are both so grateful that you've spent this afternoon with us. And we have learned so much by preparing this, but also from you all in the perspectives that you brought to this topic. So thank you, thank you, thank you for your time.
I would just add that it was not nearly enough time with you all. I really could have spent the day digging in, slowing down, and thinking together. Aimee and I are both very enthusiastic about this topic, and just building this webinar deepened our own thinking. And I really wish we could have had more time with all of you to have more conversations, hear your voices more. And not go so fast. We're so grateful that you showed up so fully. Oh, this was so fun.
I had no idea it was going to be so much fun.